third of the 1996 July lectures in physics. It's my pleasure tonight to introduce to you Dr. Anne Roberts, who is going to present tonight's lecture. Dr. Roberts started her academic career with a PhD at the University of Sydney, from where she went on to postdoctoral work at Cornell University in the United States, working on various issues involving microwave binary optics, which actually might make a good topic for a future July lecture. After a stint there, she came and joined the School of Physics here in Melbourne, where she presently heads the Optics Research Group. And
okay, well, it's good to see everybody here. What I want to talk about tonight, the title is Lasers from Atoms to the Operating Theatre. So I guess you'll get the idea that I'll be talking about lasers and ultimately various types of laser surgery. And just to give you some indication of how topical this issue is, I have here what was a full-colour ad from last Saturday's Good Weekend of In the Age. And there are a number of clinics around Melbourne that are offering laser surgery to correct refractive disorders in the eye. So the basic idea is laser surgery can, in some cases, eliminate the need for people to wear correcting glasses. A more spectacular picture actually appeared on the front cover of an optics magazine that I subscribe to. This, in fact, is a kidney stone that has been fragmented by a laser. And I'll be talking about these two techniques later on in my talk. But before I do that, I want to give you some idea of the physics behind lasers, what lasers actually are, and then ultimately just run through different types of laser surgery, just to give you a flavour for the huge variety of types of laser surgery that exist at the moment, and also why lasers are so good at doing certain things. And I'll be coming back to this later on. Okay, so as I mentioned, first of all, what I want to discuss are atoms, molecules, and other types of systems, and in particular, how light interacts with those atoms and molecules. And it's this interaction of light, and I'll be talking mainly about atoms, that actually gives rise to the existence of a laser. And one of the things that has made lasers such a useful tool is the almost parallel emergence of the optical fibre. And optical fibres, in conjunction with lasers, enable relatively non-invasive types of surgery to be performed. And that is one of the benefits of lasers in terms of surgery. So, and as I said before, in conclusion, I'll be talking about specific types of laser surgery. Now, there is a fairly strong historic link between the use of light and what can be called surgery. Even in the early part of the 20th century, skin cancers were treated with a type of dye that would selectively absorb light. And that dye would actually attack the skin cancer and lead to the tumour being reduced. So the idea of using light as a form of surgery isn't particularly new. And in fact, in 1946, someone in Germany pioneered the use of just sunlight to treat eye tumours and also detach retinas. But it wasn't really until the laser was invented in 1960, and it happened very quickly after the laser was invented, that in 1961, lasers were actually used to treat tumours in the eye in animals, and less than 2 years later, human trials were begun. So as soon as almost as soon as the laser was invented, that people started seeing its potential as a form of surgery. Now, what is a laser? Before I get too far, the word laser is actually an acronym, and what I'll be doing is going through some of these terms and explaining them. But the letters LASER stand for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. And the basic idea of a laser, as compared to, say, a normal incandescent source of light, such as a light bulb, is the fact that whereas a light bulb will produce essentially white light, and the light is going out in all directions, a laser is you can regard light as being a wave, and by large object I mean that some kind of slit that's the order of a few millimetres across, something like that. Generally then you see the wave picture of light. Now light is a wave, it's travelling very fast, in fact it's travelling at 3 by 10 to the 8 metres per second, and the wavelength of this light, so we have something that's varying in space and time, the wavelength of that wave for visible light is between about 400 and 700 nanometres, where 1 nanometre is a decimal point followed by 8 zeros per 1 metre. So the wavelength of light is very small. And as well as ascribing to a wave a wavelength, we can also assign or describe it in terms of frequency. And there is a relationship between frequency of a wave and its wavelength. And there's not too many equations in this lecture, so don't get too nervous. But basically, there is this relationship that's quite useful, mainly the fact that the speed of light is equal to frequency times the wavelength. And one thing about this relationship is that if you have long wavelength light, that corresponds to a small frequency. If you have short wavelength light, that corresponds to very high frequency. So that kind of relationship between frequency and wavelength I will be referring to on the pages. Now on the other hand, when light actually starts interacting with atoms, which is important from the point of view we're discussing tonight, it actually behaves more like a particle, or what we call a photon. And this photon is a hard thing to describe, but essentially the energy in the light wave behaves as though it's concentrated in very small bundles. And these are the bundles that are called photons. And I'll represent a photon as having something that has a kind of particle-like nature, but it also, you should also remember that it is still a light wave. And it depends on what the light is interacting with that determines whether it is exhibiting primarily hydrogen or primarily wave-like properties. Now these little particles have an energy, and that energy is related to the frequency of the wave. And because it's related to frequency, it's also related to the wavelength of the wave. So the energy of each photon is a constant called H, which is Planck's constant. Don't worry too much about that, but it's just some constant multiplied by the frequency. So the higher the frequency of the wave, the more energy is contained in each photon. And likewise, because of this inverse relationship between frequency and wavelength, if you have a long wavelength, the energy of the photon is smaller. Okay, so that's all I'm going to say about light for the time being. And what I want to do now is talk about the interaction of light atoms, and the basic model of the atom that is useful for describing what's going on in terms of the interaction of light with the atoms is a model where you've got a nucleus. The nucleus consists of particles called protons and neutrons, and I won't refer to them again, but essentially it's a positively charged nucleus, and around that are orbiting negatively charged electrons. Now, if we look at this in a bit more detail and look at what the energies of these electrons are, it turns out, and this is a result of the, or to me, is described by the Bohr model of the atom, that the electrons within the atom can have only certain discrete, firstly orbit radii, and also energies. So the energy of an electron around the nucleus cannot have just any value. It can have only certain values. So in some ways it would be like the energy be by the emission of a photon or the absorption of a photon. So if we have our electrons just dropping down to the next lowest level, it loses some energy, but that energy is transferred to a photon. So the way we light interacts with atoms is through the absorption or emission of these photons as the atom or the electron, if you like, goes from one energy level to another energy level. And there are two processes that I'll mention first. There's another process that I'll discuss in a minute. But essentially, if we have just considered two energy levels, there's a lot of energy levels within each atom. But if we just consider two of them, and suppose we have the atom in a higher energy, if it drops down to a lower energy, it will emit a photon. And the important thing to note is that the energy of this photon is actually equal to the difference in energy between these two levels here. Likewise, if we have an atom that's sitting in some lower level, and a photon comes along, and the energy of that photon happens to correspond to the difference in energy between the lower level and some upper level, then that photon can be absorbed, and the atom will end up in a higher level. Now, just one comment about this. First, or a couple of comments. Firstly, you do not get absorption if the wavelength of the photon does not correspond to the energy transfer between the atoms and the atom. So that is important later on when we come to talk about lasers, because materials will only absorb light if the wavelength of the light corresponds to two energy levels in the atom. But in terms of these energy levels, one slightly more advanced concept is the fact that although the frequency or the wavelength of the photon has to correspond to the difference in energy between two levels, in reality, materials tend to emit or absorb light that's actually spread over a small range of wavelengths centered on that wavelength corresponding to the ideal difference in energy. So, for example, if you look at the neon, which appears in here, neon laser, the wavelength that's emitted is 633 nanometers, and in fact, if it only emitted light exactly at that wavelength, this would just be a very sharp spike. In fact, it is a sharp spike, but it does have a finite width, and it's very narrow, and the width of it is about 10 to the minus 3 nanometers. So, although the frequencies do have to match the difference in energy between the two levels, there is a little bit of, because of some factors that I won't go into here, there is a little bit of difference that can be the energies or the wavelength of light that can be emitted. Right, now for demonstration. What you can see is that instead of having a continuous spectrum through the visible region, you can see that we have just a few lines appearing there. So these are the differences. These wavelengths correspond to differences in the energy levels within Mercury. And in fact, the different atoms all have characteristic spectra, and this can see that the lines there do have, they're not perfectly narrow, there's a certain width. And that's what I was talking about in terms of the line width, is that you don't just get exactly one frequency emitted or one wavelength emitted, you tend to get a little bit of a spread around that. And just to give you some other examples, we have a hydrogen lamp, but it's not very good, and you can see that hydrogen has a certain spectrum, and this would be the spectrum of a sodium lamp. Again, you have a certain series of lines, and these are where the lines appear is characteristic of different elements. Okay, so I've talked about absorption and what I call spontaneous emission, where you just have an atom sitting at a higher level and it will spontaneously drop down to a lower level and emit a photon in the process. There is another process, and this is the stimulated emission that is the SE in the word laser. And stimulated emission occurs when, if you've got two levels within an atom and you have the atom sitting at a higher level, you have a photon interacting with that atom, and if the energy of that photon again corresponds to the energy difference between those two levels, what you end up with is two photons now, where these photons are identical. So they have the same frequency, they're traveling the same direction, and they have the same polarization and phase for those of you that know about these things. So for those of you that don't, it's enough to know that these photons are exactly the same, and in particular they're traveling the same direction, same frequency, and they will add together in phase. Now, I've talked mainly here, or exclusively here so far, about atoms, where we're talking about the electrons being in certain energy levels within the atom. There are other quantized systems where you can have transitions between one energy and another energy. An example of that would be a carbon dioxide molecule. Now, all molecules can vibrate or rotate, and in particular, the carbon dioxide molecule can vibrate in a number of different modes, and the energies that the molecule has in these modes are also quantized. So the carbon dioxide molecule can't just vibrate with any energy, it must have certain discrete energies, as in the case of the electron around the hydrogen atom. So just to give you an idea of some of these vibrations, if we consider what's called the bending mode, where effectively the oxygens are changing their orientations with respect to the carbon atom. So that's the bending mode. You can also have what's called the asymmetric stretch mode, where the oxygens are, if the carbon's that, you can regard the carbon as being stationary, the oxygens will vibrate around it in an asymmetric fashion. Something like that. And another mode is a symmetric stretch, where the oxygens will vibrate in a symmetric fashion about the carbon atom. Okay, so that's the carbon dioxide molecule. Now, the energy of these different modes is quantized, and when you have a transition from one energy of vibration to another energy of vibration, that is accompanied by the emission or absorption of photons. In this case, the photons, however, are actually correspond to infrared radiation. Whereas in the case of the electronic transitions within the atom, mostly they're in the visible. In the case of these vibrational transitions within molecules, they tend to be in the infrared. And this is useful from the point of view of being able to create a laser that operates in the infrared. Now, there's a variety of other systems that I just don't have time to go into that can be used to create lasers. One of the big growth areas at the moment is the development of semiconductor lasers, and there's a wide range of materials that can be used to make semiconductor lasers, for example, variations on gallium arsenide. And semiconductor lasers at the moment can be produced to produce light in the infrared, ranging down to blue light, which the blue light diode lasers are in the experimental phase at the moment. So these are the types of lasers that you have, for example, in the CD player. You can also have what are referred to as eczema lasers that consist of excited states and molecules that contain rare earth elements. And the example of that would be argon fluoride. And transitions within these eczemas correspond to the production of ultraviolet photons. And there is also a type of laser that is fairly experimental at the moment, known as a free electron laser, and it can produce ultraviolet light or even down to close to X-ray. So, although I've emphasised atoms, I don't want you to think that that's the only way that you can have a laser operating just on electrons undergoing transitions in an atom. I've also talked about molecules, and there are other things as well. So, a laser, the term laser can be used to describe okay, so I'll talk about stimulated emission. How about light amplification, the LA in the laser? Well, to achieve that, we have to do what is referred to as pumping to some kind of material or a system. And the point of pumping is that, in general, you tend to have most of your atoms, if you go back to our atomic system, most of the atoms are sitting around in the lower energy levels. And if you want to produce light by stimulated emission, what you really want is to have your atoms sitting in the higher energy levels. So to do that, you need to pump your system or your medium so that you end up with more atoms actually in the higher energy level. So to do that, you actually have to put energy in. You can't just, you don't get something for nothing in this world. So you have to put energy in, and the result of that is that you create what's called a population inversion. And a population inversion simply is that you have, if you just consider two levels within an atom, you have lots of atoms sitting around in the upper level and very few atoms sitting around the lower level. And if you look at the difference between the number of atoms in the higher level, the number of atoms in the lower level, you want the difference between these numbers to be as large as possible. Because the bigger the difference in these two numbers is, the more light amplification you can achieve. And there are a number of ways of achieving pumping. Firstly, for example, in lasers such as the carbon dioxide laser or a helium neon laser, you can put an electric discharge through a gas, and that will pump the system up to higher levels. As I'll mention later on, helium neon lasers actually pretty complicated, and I'll explain how that fits in. A common technique is also optical pumping, where you can use, for example, an arc lamp or another laser to pump the system. It might seem a bit perverse to use a laser to create another laser, but it's in fact an extremely useful technique. And in the case of semiconductor lasers, you can directly pass a current through your diode, effectively, to pump the system up to a higher level. And if you have created a population inversion, the point of light amplification is that if you pass light, if you have some material that has population inversion, you pass light at the appropriate wavelength, and by that I mean that the wavelength corresponds to the energy difference between your inverted levels within your medium. You put that light in here, you pass it through, you get more light out the other end. So another way of thinking about that is that you put a certain number of photons, the right energy in, and you get more photons with that same energy coming out the other end. So it's the process of stimulated emission leads to the intensity of your light than if you just pass the light through the medium once. Effectively, you're passing your light through the medium many times before it leaves the laser cavity. So this is called the cavity. Now, I've mentioned here that this provides amplification, so that's what I was discussing, so you get more amplification than if you didn't have a cavity. The other thing it does is it improves what's known as the spectral purity, and you can, if you think back to the line width that I talked about before, by placing your atoms within this cavity, you can actually get narrower line width light being produced. So the way this is achieved is through the fact that these cavities possess modes, and these modes are analogous to standing waves on a string, and I happen to have a string here that I can set vibrating, and most of you, well, depends how much physics background you've got, but some of you may have experienced this before, but you can see that I have this string now vibrating in one mode, which has very little movement at either end, and a maximum movement in the middle. Now, as I also want you to listen to this as I increase this, you'll hear the frequency, the pitch that's being produced has increased, and now you'll see that this string is vibrating so that it is effectively not moving at either end, and there is no movement also in the middle. So this is another mode. And I can keep increasing the frequency. You can hear the sound is higher. And now I have a node pattern which has, these are actually called nodes, these regions where the string is moving, nodes at either end and at two more positions between. So here we have a range of modes, and I don't think I'll tempt fate by. But you get the general idea. I can keep, theoretically anyway, pushing this up higher and higher frequencies and have more and more modes which have more and more of these stationary points within the pattern. So you get the same sort of thing in the laser cavity, and each of these modes corresponds to a specific wavelength or a specific frequency in terms of frequencies, and it is those wavelengths, those frequencies that are amplified compared to the other frequencies around them. So if we go back to our line width, remember this would be the shape of, for example, the neon in helium neon laser. When we go and put that in some kind of cavity, we have specific wavelengths that are amplified compared to the other wavelengths. So what you actually get out of a cavity, instead of this relatively broad wavelength light, you now have a series of very narrow peaks, and if you include some kind of filter within the system, you can actually just pick out one of these. So the actual range of wavelength that are produced by a laser is far less than the range of wavelength that is produced by an atom on its own. Alright, so I've talked about the basic idea behind the laser. I just want to go through one more basic piece of physics about lasers before I get on to surgery and optical fibres. Firstly, lasers, I've been just talking about systems where you've got interactions between two levels. In practice, it is impossible to get a steady state laser operation with just two levels. What happens is that, and again, you can probably imagine this, is if you have some kind of population inversion with a lot of atoms in the upper level and a few atoms in the lower level, as soon as you start getting transitions for producing your laser wavelength, you're actually depleting this system here. So you actually, it's actually impossible to get a steady state laser operating with just two levels. So you need to have at least three levels in a laser to get a steady state laser operating. And effectively, your three level laser consists of a lower level or ground level, a high level that has a very short lifetime, which means that the atoms don't actually get what's called a steady state population inversion, where you build up a lot of atoms in this higher level here, and you end up with population inversion between this level and this level, so your laser radiation would correspond to transition from the long lifetime level to the ground state there. So this is one way of achieving a steady state laser operation. However, it's fairly inefficient because you actually need to put a lot of atoms, at least half the atoms, into this upper level here before you actually get a population inversion. And this problem can be avoided by using a four-level laser, because if you choose a system where you have four levels and where this level naturally has very few atoms in it, then as soon as you put any atoms into this long lifetime level up here, you've effectively achieved a population inversion. So you can then have your laser transition from being between this long lifetime level and this short lifetime level. And as soon as, by this having a short lifetime, it means that as soon as the atoms get to this level, they are very rapidly drained away. grant. There's another laser that is commonly used in medicine, near UVA laser. This is an example of a four-level laser. The four levels have been labelled 0, 1, 2, and 3. 3 actually consists of a group, or the uppermost level with the short lifetime actually consists of a group of bands of energies. So you pump them up there. They end up in this level that has a fairly long lifetime, so the atoms hang around in there. This level down here has a fairly short lifetime, so the atoms are quickly brought back down to this upper level again. And the wavelength of the light that's produced is 1.064 microns, which I will talk more about later on. So they're just some real systems to give you an idea, give you a feel of the fact that things are a little bit more complicated than just two simple levels. And before I start talking about medical applications, there are, of course, a range of other applications. One is welding. This is another nice picture I've obtained recently. This is a CO2 laser, carbon dioxide laser. Remember, that's in the far infrared. That is pretty indistinct, but that is effectively is welding some kind of fuel filter, just using the heat from the laser light here. So welding in industry using lasers is quite common. Lasers are very useful for range finding and surveying. Your CD players have all got a laser in them, and most supermarkets now have barcode readers that also rely on lasers. Okay, so then I come to the discussion of laser surgery. Now, the advantages of lasers in surgery, there are several. Firstly, lasers are extremely intense, so they can be used, for example, to remove tissue and, in some cases, simultaneously cauterize the wound and also excite shock waves. You can also exploit the wavelength selectivity of the laser, which is a very useful thing. The light should also chemically interact with certain dyes, and one of the most important things too is that it's very easy to deliver laser light to remote parts of the body by an optical fibre, and that doesn't actually involve cutting the person open to quite the same degree that if you use the scalpel. And in terms of the interaction of light with tissue, there's a number of things that can happen when light enters some kind of material medium. Firstly, the light can be either scattered, it can be reflected, it can be absorbed or transmitted straight through that tissue. Now, you will only get absorption of the light, and I've said this before, if the atoms or the molecules within that tissue have transitions, and the transition wavelength would be lambda, that actually corresponds to the laser wavelength, lambda naught. So because you've got this monochromatic light, you can actually have situations where laser light will pass through certain parts of tissue and not interact with it at all, and then it will be absorbed in another kind of tissue. And that's one of the advantages when we come to eye surgery. So this is just a schematic showing some of these processes. If you've got light coming down here going from one medium into another, some of the light will be reflected, some of it goes through, some of it will be just scattered, and if it interacts with some target, this could be a number of things I'll talk about later, the light can be absorbed if the wavelength between light corresponds to the transition wavelength of some of the molecules within the target. If, on the other hand, the wavelength of the laser light does not correspond to any of the absorption wavelengths of the target, then the light will just pass straight through. And this is a very handy feature of lasers. Now, in terms of surgery, there's a number of processes that can occur when you have the light interacting with a certain type of target. The most common form of laser surgery relies on actually just heating something. Now, that heating, this might sound a bit revolting, but what it actually does is it performs what's known as photocoagulation, which effectively just means few hundred microns. And if you look at this, you'll see at the ends of this that some of the plastic's been stripped off, and you can actually see the outer part splaying. I'll just pass it around. If you drop it, you'll probably never find it again. Lead to the whole thing fragmenting, so it can be much more easily removed from the body. There's also a number of applications of lasers to cosmetic surgery. In particular, if you consider birthmarks, which actually result of there being an excess of blood vessels under the skin, this is known as a port wine birthmark. If you take what's called an argon laser, and that produces either blue or green light, and if that is administered in very short pulses to this region, then that can actually lead to the destruction of those excess blood vessels, and the birthmark is removed. This isn't very clear, but this image is of very high quality, but the birthmark has basically been removed. They're huge pulses because if you use a continuous source of light, that actually leads to extensive heating of the surrounding region, and that can ultimately end up scarring tissue that you don't want damaged at all. Now, I also mentioned the use of dyes with lasers, and this is the basis of a new area of surgery called photodynamic therapy, which is a form of treatment for cancer. A dye can be injected into tumours, and the dye is, in fact, specific types of dyes are actually selectively absorbed by the tumour rather than the surrounding tissue. Now, if you illuminate the tumour, which has been impregnated with dye, with a blue-violet laser, then you can actually observe the tumour via fluorescence. So you can have very strong fluorescence that makes the tumours far more visible. Now, if you decide that photodynamic therapy is the most appropriate form of treatment for that type of tumour, you can then illuminate your tumour, still with your dye in it, with red light. That red light creates a chemical reaction with the dye and produces an excited state of an oxygen molecule. And this oxygen molecule is actually toxic to the cell membrane and ultimately leads to the disintegration of the tumour. So this is an example, just incidentally, of one type of laser being used to pump another type of laser. So you've got an argon laser that actually pumps different types of laser. So these are just some images. This is an image taken with an endoscope of a tumour in the throat. It is then impregnated with a dye, and it is illuminated with an optical fibre with the red light, and you can see that it is glowing somewhat. And it is then illuminated with the red light, and that leads to the tumour disintegrating. So you can see in this after picture that the tumour has been substantially removed. So that's one form of treatment for cancer. There's also been a large growth in the use of lasers in eye surgery, and as I mentioned before, one of the first applications of lasers to surgery was with eye surgery, just to eye surgery. And there's a number of different things, for example, corneal sculpting, secondary cataracts can be removed, and certain conditions known as diabetic retinopathy can be treated. Now, in terms of the treating refractive disorders, or corneal sculpting, that's what this is all about. These lasers they're using, they're actually an eczema laser. If you look at this exam, it's an eczema laser. What that actually does is changes the shape of the cornea. So that's the point of all this sort of thing, and why glasses can be replaced by this treatment. And effectively, problems with your vision that are due to refractive disorders, such as short-sightedness or nearsightedness, are a result of the fact that the curvature of the eye is such that you cannot form sharp images on the retina. For example, in a short-sighted eye, the cornea, which does most of the focusing of the eye, in the eye, most of the actual focusing is done by the cornea, which is just this curved interface here. And curvature is too sharp compared, or too strong compared to the length of the eye, what happens is the image actually is formed slightly in front of the retina rather than on the retina. So one way of treating this is for the person to wear slightly diverging lenses so that you actually end up with a sharp image formed on the retina. The way that what happens is you use an excimer laser, and what you call an ultraviolet laser, where the wavelength is about 193 nanometers or 0.193 microns. And these are relatively high energy photons. Remember, this is a short wavelength for visible light, so that means the photons have a relatively high energy compared to visible light. And this energy actually will break bonds and lead to basically tissue being vaporized. So the laser illuminates the cornea through some kind of mask, and a region can be just vaporized. And very short pulses are used, about 10 nanoseconds long, and the amount of tissue that's removed is tiny, about 0.2 of a micron. So that is just vaporized. So by changing the shape of this mask, you can selectively remove different amounts of the cornea from different parts of it, so you can actually change the shape of the cornea, so that that means that refractive disorders can be substantially dealt with, rather than having to use corrective lenses. Another form of eye surgery is the removal of the secondary cataracts that form after an artificial lens is implanted. Now, if someone gets cataracts, they, and I'm no medico, so I don't know the details of this, but people tend to have an artificial lens implanted. And it's a fairly common side effect that secondary cataracts actually appear behind the cornea and the new artificial lens that's just been implanted. Now, if you take the near-union YAG laser, and this is, I showed you the energy levels for this before, that has a wavelength of 1.06 microns. If you focus that on the cataract, this particular wavelength does not interact at all with the cornea, which is at the front of the eye, or the lens itself. So actually, while I've got my eye picture up here, these cataracts end up forming behind the artificial lens. So the light actually just passes straight through the cornea and the lens without damaging at all. And effectively, you end up with a lot of energy being dumped into this cataract, and you end up with a shockwave being produced. And this is an image of the hole that's been created in the cataract due to the shockwave. So that means that the opaque region is removed and the person can see clearly again. And another condition that can be treated using lasers, and it does rely on the wavelength selectivity of light. Diabetic retinopathy is a condition which leads to bleeding on the retina, and that can ultimately lead to blindness if it's not totally treated. Then if you take an argon laser which produces green light, that green light is not absorbed at all by the cornea, the aqueous humor, the lens, or any of the other tissue in the eye until it gets to the retina. And that green light is strongly absorbed by the melanin in the retina. So what that does is it causes heating here, it can actually cauterize this bleeding here. And so this is a before picture of the retina, this is an after picture, and you can see that the bleeding has been substantially reduced. There's another thing that they do when they treat this condition, and that is they actually, you can see there's little spots here, they actually just go and effectively zap little parts of the retina, and that, for reasons that are not known, as far as I know, are not known, actually prevent the recurrence of this problem to a certain extent. So one of the nice things about laser vision eye surgery is that the light can pass through the tissue, or light with a certain wavelength can pass through the cornea and other parts of the eye and only be selectively absorbed by the part of the eye if you want to perform surgery. Okay, another technique that is actually fairly experimental at the moment is known as laser angioplasty, where if you've got a blocked artery, they can thread an optical fibre or endoscope through the artery and illuminate that image with a UV laser, and again that can substantially remove the blockage. So here you've got the artery, and you see there's no blood down here, so it's blocked. After it's been zapped with the laser, you can see there's some blood getting through. And the conventional technique that's used at the moment is via a balloon catheter, and if that is used as well as the laser, then it can completely remove the blockage. Now this isn't entirely effective, because of course you might think, well, why not just use a balloon catheter? laser, but this is a technique that's currently under investigation. It may end up being ultimately more effective than the balloon catheter technique. Another technique that is fairly experimental at the moment is welding nerve tissues together. And there's two ways of doing this. Firstly, if you've got two nerves that need to be reattached, you've got a nerve that's been broken that needs to be basically stuck back together again. If the outer membranes are overlapped and the tissue heated, then that actually leads to new bonds forming in the outer nerve membrane, and the nerve is effectively stuck back together because you get this kind of coagulation occurring, and the new tissue that grows is such that it actually holds the nerve together. Now, a technique that's currently under investigation at Macquarie University in Sydney relies on the use of protein solder, and I apologise for the quality of this picture, but up the top here you can see your nerve is being broken at this point here, and this is a type of protein which is adhered to the outside of the nerve, so it can just be sort of stuck in a temporary kind of way just by surface tension, and if it is then illuminated with a laser, it can be heated and it actually sticks to this nerve, so it acts as kind of like a staple for the nerves. So the nerve can be stuck back together again. So that's another experimental technique. Okay, well there's a raft of other techniques, some of which are experimental and some of which are used routinely. One that is used routinely is the CO2 laser, which is used to remove precancerous cells on the cervix. Basically, the tissue, precancerous tissue on the cervix is heated and the tissue just dies and is removed, so the problem is treated. This is one of the most effective and commonly used forms of surgery for this problem. Lasers are also used in arthroscopic surgery. So if you're a footballer and you've done a knee, one possible form of treatment is using a laser to actually do the sorts of things that a surgeon would using conventional surgery would use a scalpel for. Another one, for those of you that hate having a teeth drill, people are looking into using lasers as an alternative to drilling. So effectively they're looking at using lasers to just remove hard tissue so they can remove the material without having to use a drill, and this would be a lot less painful than the vibrations coming through. Okay, well, in conclusion, I hope I've given you some kind of flavour for the extensive use of lasers in medicine and for some of the benefits of using lasers and some of the physics behind those benefits. And in fact, there's been an enormous growth in the use of lasers since they were invented about 30 odd years ago. And it's in conjunction with optical fibres that they find their real application because they can be used very extensively in minimally invasive surgery. And there's still a lot of ongoing research into this subject. There's a lot of work going into development of new types of lasers. They're needed to develop special fibres because the fibres that are used for telecommunications are usually completely inappropriate for laser surgery. And there's also a lot of research going on at the moment into the interaction between light and actual tissue and development of new forms of laser surgery. Thank you. Gas, they can in the longer term, I think the visible light, there aren't any, people aren't concerned about any long-term side effects. With eczema lasers, because of that ultraviolet light, that is corresponds to very high energy photons, and there is some concern that that could possibly cause some damage to important molecules, but they haven't really witnessed it so far. Laser surgery. And one of the things is that the temperature is fairly high power in lasers, laser surgery.
number of them in an array about sew by sew. And mirrors are very simple. They're just four mirrors arranged so that light coming in from any direction will be turned around and sent back from the same direction whence it came. It's a very simple, passive piece of equipment. You can just hit it with a laser from Earth. The laser spreads out to 100 metres in diameter by the time it hits the moon, and you can see the reflection. You have to wait a little while. Okay, well, look, I think we better call a halt there. Can I remind people that there is still one further lecture in the 1996 program, which will take place next Friday, 11 o'clock, How Things Fly, Why Boomerangs Come Back, by Professor Jeff Popat. I will also invite you to take advantage of the tea, coffee and biscuits that we have available for you at the foyer. And if you want a copy of some of Dr. Roberts' slides there, she has made them available down here, only $2 a copy. So once again,